Transmitting from the Mojave Wilderness in Joshua Tree, California, now is the time for Desert Oracle Radio, the voice of the desert.
Tonight we are going to talk a little bit about skinwalkers. There's something alive that's part of this place, this haunted ranch, really just a ranchette, 480 acres, but good pasture, a creek through the property, lots of mature trees, mostly big cottonwoods. There are a couple of homestead cabins on the property. I guess you could call them fixer-uppers. They're in real bad shape, and they're also haunted, like everything on this ranch. In the middle 1990s, a family from New Mexico bought this small ranch up in northeastern Utah, tucked between a lot of tribal land, rural land. They were in the business of breeding cattle. If you like that cold, intermountain west kind of desert, you'd like it up there, but it's kind of dreary too. It's hard to explain. Well, the family fled the property after a couple of years. They kept seeing monster wolves roaming around, red-eyed beasts, shadowy human figures, strange craft moving across the sky. The ranch was purchased by a Las Vegas billionaire who studies UFOs and the paranormal. On the line, the documentary filmmaker and friend of the Desert Oracle, Jeremy Corbell. Jeremy, welcome back to Desert Oracle Radio.
Thanks, Ken. It's always an honor to be on. Excited to be with you.
Now, you have a new movie out. In fact, we started this show, Desert Oracle Radio, 1 year ago, and you also had a new movie out. But this is a different one. This is Hunt for the Skinwalker.
Wow, that's crazy. 1 year ago. Yes, this is a new film, Hunt for the Skinwalker. First time ever, people get to see footage from Skinwalker Ranch and both owners, previous and current, on camera interviewing for the first time. Billionaire Robert Bigelow is on camera talking about the ranch. This is a first. It's also a first. The new owner goes on camera and talks about the ranch. We've never had a single piece of video footage come off the ranch. And you have hours of it, just hours of it now. And this breaks some news, man. This really breaks some news. You know, we all learned about a year ago that the United States government was studying the UFO phenomenon through the New York Times. We learned that last year. $22 million was spent to investigate so-called flying saucers. But the real story is much bigger. There was not just one UFO study, there were two. And the Pentagon's other larger investigation delved into these mysteries that are far more disturbing than alien spacecraft, and they focus in those studies on the living laboratory that we call Skinwalker Ranch. So this film breaks that news, man. That hasn't even been reported by Fox News, New York Times, anybody. This is actually through the Department of Defense as well. This is the mother program. It was called AWSAP. And what they did was they funded the Defense Intelligence Agency program.
So this second group that you're talking about...
It's a larger, it's kind of like a mother program. It's the dirty little secret. The United States government was not just studying a reactionary program called ATIP, you know, government-military interactions with UFOs. In fact, the host program, this one I'm talking about, AWSAP, was studying what we would call the paranormal. And yes, they funded it through the Defense Intelligence Agency. It's far beyond UFOs. There have been three major scientific studies at Skinwalker Ranch of what we would call the paranormal and UFOs. There have been three scientific studies. The first was the private industry study by Robert Bigelow called NIDS, National Institute for Discovery Science. After that, there was a study that was done by the Defense Intelligence Agency, funded through AWSAP, Advanced Aerospace Weapon System Applications Program. So now there's a third study under new ownership, private industry of the ranch. At least I'm going to say it's private industry. There may be further interest.
In watching Hunt for the Skinwalker, The viewer sees a lot of what looks like an earlier attempt at a TV documentary by George Knapp.
Yeah, George Knapp is the OG godfather of breaking stories like UFOs and the paranormal. He is a mainstream news journalist at KLAS who broke the Area 51 and the Bob Lazar story. He's also credited with like maybe 28 Emmys, Peabody Awards, multiples. I mean, the guy's a seasoned veteran in journalism. And he has been studying and documenting as the only journalist ever allowed on the ranch to document the progression of the studies for decades. Active, ongoing investigations while the events were unfolding at this ranch in Utah that had captured the imagination and interest of our Defense Intelligence Agency. Man, you want to film that. So that's what he was doing. He was collecting that footage, interviewing the scientists as events were unfolding. This can never happen again. It will never happen again. It can't. And that's what that footage is, woven into the fabric of current day events in my film, Hunt for the Skinwalker. But that footage could never come out. Now, in the wake of transition of ownership of the ranch, I was able to take that historic documentary vintage footage and integrate it into the new and current footage on the ranch that I have.
Your movie documents this frustrating attempt over many years to try to nail down whatever's happening at this kind of haunted ranch. Those guys were out there for years and years, and for whatever combination of reasons, they really don't have anything more than some stories.
What you're bringing up is something that I'm going to disagree with, but everybody brings it up, and I think it's important because that's the obvious, like, it appears that way, because in one sense it's true. So you're saying there are scientists that were there for, let's say, the NIDS investigation for 7 years. Okay, what did they leave with? Obviously, science, as George says, science got its ass kicked, right? Obviously, they didn't get what they were looking for, and they were looking to either look for prosaic causes for what's been going on at this, you know, hell mouth, as you call it, of a ranch, where, you know, everything from paranormal to poltergeist to UFOs occurs. But what factually, tangibly, did science, was it able to determine? And a lot of people say, well, there isn't evidence. You know, they couldn't get any evidence. All they have is stories. I'm going to argue the absolute opposite. In fact, there is loads of evidence. First of all, do you figure that witness testimony from multiple witnesses that don't know each other from different angles of perception on one event, is that evidence? And I would argue, yes.
It is. But what's common is that groups of people can have these experiences, and they're definitely real to the people who experience it, but there's nothing there that can be captured by a camera. Or when you do get something, you get light blobs, and then you talk to the people and they're, oh, you know, I saw a triangle ship and a being with red eyes, and
right.
You know, so they're real, obviously. They took place, the events took place, but
there is an elusive nature, and we all have to come to terms with the intelligence that is there is probably an intelligence, and it is aware of our sophisticated electronic devices, that sort of thing. And if it doesn't want to expose itself, it has been able to not expose itself. However, there is physical evidence. Would you call a mutilated corpse, if it was a human body, you'd consider that physical evidence? Well, we have that. We've documented that. There's ice circle carvings that we know were done with tools. There is footage of stuff like the Twin Towers apparitions. But here's the big question, and this is where we get to a point where I think we're going to agree. Evidence of what? There is evidence, tons of it in the film, but evidence of what? And that's what I don't know.
Having been out there for that time, I'm talking about the original Bigelow team, the NIDS team.
143 incidents in a 7-year period. So not every night. You know, that leaves a bigger mystery. What was this thing that crawled out of an orange geometric inverted porthole witnessed by two physicists, you know, through night vision? What was that? But remember, there was a second study. So the next study that came in was the Defense Intelligence study, where they allocated the money to BASS. That was the name of the group. What were they interested in? One of the things they were interested in is national security. How can you send craft through a porthole, through a rip in space, in the sky, and put that onto a battleground? They were interested in that. If they're witnessing that at the ranch, they want to know how to do that or deploy soldiers. Weird stuff.
In watching your movie and reading the book and following this for many years in the press, going back to that original Deseret News story in the 1990s, what occurs to me still is that Mrs. Sherman seems to be the key to the whole thing. Has she ever been brought back out there with these various investigative teams?
Absolutely wants nothing to do with the ranch, the property, the story, anything. They would not go on camera. They would not be interviewed modern day for the film. There's no interest. Remember, if this is real, it's terrifying. And that's what the sense that I get from the family that you mentioned.
Right. But for a long time, her husband, the rancher, he did work there with NIDS, both as kind of a caretaker and to try to point them in the direction where experiences had happened to his family, right?
He wanted to get to the bottom of it. He had his cattle mutilated, his dogs murdered. He was being run off his property, he thought at first, by the United States government. He wanted to figure out who was flying these ships and doing these kinds of strange things. Yes, he wanted answers. He was bold, strong, smart, well-educated, and tried to help the NIDS team hunt or stalk whatever this phenomenon is. Again, they were not successful. It followed them. There was a hitchhiker effect with the phenomenon itself, which I've heard over and over by DIA, by local authorities. It follows you. It followed him and his family through two states. It's corrosive. It seems to attach to you and slowly buries itself within you. It's very strange.
The encounters and the activity always went way up when she was there.
Well, there are people that seem to antagonize the phenomenon, but let's go a little bit broader. We need to really look at it this way. Skinwalker Ranch was a living laboratory, is a living laboratory used to study a much larger, global, enduring, historic phenomenon around since ancient times. So it is a great place to observe it. Is it only happening on the ranch? Is it invoked most by the old, owner? No, not at all. The Uinta Basin is inundated with bizarre, high strangeness. The phenomenon expresses itself, gives performances, in fact, all throughout the Uinta Basin and probably all throughout the world, but we're seeing it in a heightened state there in the Uinta Basin. And that's what this movie really engages, is this story of how our government studied the paranormal.
Tell me about the screening of Hunt for the Skinwalker.
We had a private screening in Las Vegas with some, really kind of interesting guests that came in and got to see the movie for themselves, people involved, in fact, with the story.
Now, I heard that one of the people in the New York Times UFO study group story last year, Lou Elizondo, the former head of this Pentagon UFO study group, was that at your movie?
I heard that as well.
How do you like it?
I can't comment on that any further. I shouldn't comment on that any further. But yeah, it was look, really interesting people were in the crowd that night, and people that were involved with this story on multiple levels.
Was Robert Bigelow there?
Again, it was a private screening.
So Hunt for the Skinwalker has been out on iTunes for the past week plus now. What does it do next?
We were number one top documentary on iTunes, and then it was hovering between number one and four for days. We really hit a nerve, man. That's kind of what I'm noticing.
In Hunt for the Skinwalker, the book ends with a request for information on similar places around the world, because it's not just something that happens on this 480-acre ranch. It's a phenomenon that shows up in different places around the world. Now, I know NIDS at one point was looking for other properties like this to study.
Yes, there were other locations. I say properties, I'm not sure. Locations, absolutely. Other locations identified both by the Defense Intelligence Agency as well as by private industry in these studies. Yeah, the book really opened the gates there. And there are other places like this, other pockets in the world where they say, the veil is thin.
There are indeed places and seasons when and where the veil is thin, the veil between worlds, between our flesh and blood and garbage world and that one we have either imagined into existing on the other side or that may truly exist independent of our longings, our dreams. But that veil becomes as solid as a concrete wall when we market it, when we try to prove it, when we claim to understand it. You have been listening to Desert Oracle Radio. Good night from the Voice of the Desert.
This is like the Area 51 of the paranormal.
So many things have happened on the properties that have not been made public.
Going public now.
It is perhaps the most important scientific effort of our time.
The Pentagon and CIA,
they've been investigating encounters with the paranormal at the ranch.
We're talking about unidentified flying objects. UFOs.
The program received more than $20 million for its work.
This is a potential threat, a grave one to our country.
And everybody who lives there knows about it.
Something is here.
Right above my head, and I could hit it with a tennis ball.
The Skinwalker is extraterrestrial.
We are on the eve of something momentous.
Will any of the fingers be pointing toward Skinwalker Ranch?